the curse of the werewolf that was laid on a baby who grew into a man possessed by a monster. To this Spanish town, the night brought drinking and dancing, music and girls, and the moon. The full moon that turned an innocent man into a savage beast. The curse of the werewolf. A man possessed by a desperate need for love, who found in Christina all the passionate sincerity of youth.
Christina, do you love me? Will you marry me, Christina?
You say you love me, will you marry me?
Yes. Yes, I will.
Wow, what a beauty. What a beauty. This is nice. Full color pictures, a historical accounting of the Hammer films. You couldn't ask for a better reference manual. As a matter of fact, many of the films that I talk about in the Hammer franchise, I've taken information directly from this book by Marcus Hearns, and it is a great book indeed. Great, great book. Really, really enjoy having this in my collection. Don't regret one bit about upping the money and purchasing this classic book. Goes through all the Hammer films, gives you behind the scene information, kind of like the origin of each film, and it's just simply great. It's a simply great book. I love it. But this, ooh, what's this? The Curse of the Werewolf. Now, what do you make of that? That's exactly the film that I'm going to talk about today.
I can't praise this book enough. It is just a marvel in the cinematic nature of Hammer films. Lots of behind the scenes information. Great, great trip back in time to look at the mechanics of how these films were made, some of the politics in making these films. This book is just a complete joy. I really, really am so happy that I purchased this. But today's film, like I said, is The Curse of the Werewolf. And I think my very first time in knowing anything about this film was way back when I was in middle school. At the time, we used to have a day in the library, I believe it was usually on a Friday, where we would have all these pre-orders where kids could go in and pre-order all these books. You had this little flyer that would come in and you'd have these books that you would see advertised in there. You'd take the little flyer home, you know, ask mom and dad for money. Hey mom, I want this book. Will you help me get this book? It was to encourage reading. So the flyer came in and lo and behold, one of the books was a monster book. And Curse of the Werewolf was featured on the cover of this book that you could order for kids to read. So I took the flyer home. Mom, you gotta buy me this book. I mean, it's great, man. I want this book. And what do you know? She up and anteed the money. I went and got the book. And that was my first exposure to Curse of the Werewolf. Now, of course, at that time, I had never seen the film. And it would be a few years later before I actually got to see the film. And I gotta tell you, my memory of this film was actually pretty vague. But what I remember more than anything is the creature design and special makeup. That werewolf was simply terrifying to me as a kid. I can remember that werewolf so vividly. Because the makeup was so different than anything we'd seen before. The werewolf was just so terrifying. And to this day, that image of the werewolf in that publicity shot carrying the young girl is a shot that I just simply have never forgotten. And it's been a film that, you know, when I saw it as a kid, it terrified me. I was simply afraid of this film, afraid of the creature in this film, the atmosphere that the film created. But of course, you know, I was a kid, and in a kid's eye, sometimes things are a lot more real than they are when you grow up. Now, if I was to give a little history on the film, a little brief history on the movie, it is that it is actually an adaptation of a 1933 novel by Guy Endore, and hopefully I'm pronouncing his last name correctly. And the novel was called The Werewolf of Paris. Now, the Hammer staple, Anthony Hines, who usually wrote under the name John Elder, actually adapted the story of Werewolf in Paris to become The Curse of the Werewolf. And at this time, Universal Studios owned the rights to the werewolf character, and they actually subcontracted Hammer Studios to actually make a film of their beloved character. And before I go any further, Curse of the Werewolf is actually, believe it or not, the only werewolf film that Hammer Studios ever made. And that in itself is totally kind of unbelievable. Because you would think that a studio who is known for multiple films in the Dracula franchise, several Frankenstein films, mummy films, but only one werewolf film. And I gotta admit, that's a disappointing fact to me, because I think that Curse of the Werewolf was definitely a step in the right direction. And Hammer could have had a really fruitful werewolf series, in my humble opinion. One of the things that you might find a little bit surprising, or at least a subtle change from the novel Werewolf in Paris is that the film does not take place in Paris. And I gotta say, this little fact surprised me because I was at least expecting the movie to be seated in the UK somewhere. But to my surprise, the movie actually takes place in Spain. And there's a very valid reason for this. Now, before this film began production, Hammer had set their sights on making a film about the Inquisition. And the film that they were intending to make was entitled The Inquisitor. And the problem that they were having, the subject matter of the film, and the fact that the Catholic Church would be so associated with the movie, Hammer feared backlash from the church, basically. And as a matter of fact, the church had also threatened to boycott the film if they indeed made it. And also, across the pond here in the United States, Columbia Pictures, who was financing The Inquisitor, were also quite a bit nervous about the film that Hammer had intended to make. And they kind of backed down and backed out. And so did Hammer. They thought that, you know, though they wanted to make the film, they really didn't feel like it would be worth all the trouble that it could possibly cause. So we had entire sets that were built for The Inquisitor, which, you know, would have also been subtitled The Rape of Sabina. And I could just imagine the Catholic Church going crazy just over that name in the title of the film, The Rape of Sabina. But anyway, the sets had been constructed for The Inquisitor, and Hammer had spent quite a bit of money on building these sets. And to not allow them to be a complete financial waste, they decided to reuse and possibly redress some of these sets and place the film Curse of the Werewolf in Spain. So that's why we have a werewolf film put out by Hammer Studios that takes place in Spain. Now, as I said, both Columbia and Hammer felt it wise to abandon The Inquisitor because they feared the backlash from the Catholic Church, and probably rightly so. But that was only the beginning of Hammer's problems, because the British Board of Film Censors was the next rival to overcome. Now, these people had always given Hammer a hard time because their films and the subject matter in those films always kept them up in arms. And Hammer was constantly being censored and being told what not to put into their films and what would be allowed. So the board was a very, very relevant force on their shoulders. And usually what Hammer would do in those days is they would turn over the scripts to the board, and the board would review those scripts, and, you know, they would recommend, you know, no, you can't do this, you can't do that, no, this is too harsh. And given that Hammer had made some fairly risque films at the time, by the time of Curse of the Werewolf, the script was reviewed and many, many changes had to be done before they would green light this movie. And as a matter of fact, the board actually, you know, many people were actually against horror films of the day. You know, if they'd had their way, there would really be no horror films at all. But Hammer was really under scrutiny for The Curse of the Werewolf. Now, the person responsible for reviewing the scripts of The Curse of the Werewolf was John Trevelyan. And he read the script, he studied it, he decided, you know, one of the more interesting things that could not be allowed was the fact that in the movie, the servant girl ends up being raped by one of the beggars in a prison cell. And of course, in the actual film, you can tell what's going to happen. The subtleties are all there. You know that the young girl is going to be raped. When the camera pans away, you know what's going on. And that in itself was a pretty risque thing back in the day also. And it was a pretty harsh scene. I thought it was really harsh. I thought it was effective. I thought it was... I can understand why the board would want to appropriate changes in that scene. But originally, how the scene was supposed to play was that Hammer had actually written John Elder that the beggar was actually a half wolf man. And if Hammer had had their way, he would have raped the girl as a partial wolf man. And I'm sure the censors of that day felt like that was bordering on bestiality. So, you know, the board said, you can have the rape scene, but you can have it without the man being a wolf creature. Now, you can have the man as a wolf creature with fangs and sharp teeth, but if that's the case, he cannot rape the woman. So that totally had to be given up. So what we got in the actual finished film was the fact that a beggar rapes the girl. And, you know, as far as we can tell, the beggar was simply a crazed man who had been locked up for years and years and lost his mind. Which, I'll go into that a little bit later, because the scene itself is just not so effective as it would have been had changes not been made. But also, originally, if that scene had been filmed the way Hammer wanted it to be filmed, we have the Marquis, the guy who was in charge of this establishment in the film, a very, very cruel and sadistic man. Now, I gotta say, I hated this guy. But, you know, originally it was written that he not only ordered that the girl be imprisoned, but he actually stood there and watched her be raped while this wolf, half-wolf creature raped the young woman. And, you know, you gotta wonder. You know, the Hammer films were risque as they were when we actually did get to see the finished film. I often wonder, though, after reading up on this film, how would it have been to actually see a Hammer film with no outside rules? If they were actually allowed to do what the hell they really wanted to do. Now, of course, the films would possibly be tamed by today's standards. But if Hammer had really been allowed to make these movies the way they wanted to make them without censorship, how would those movies have been? Would they still be this classic, legendary film company of today? Or would they be looked on as like the black sheep of film studios that crossed the lines and did too much? How would we feel if the servant girl was actually raped by a half-man, half-wolf creature while someone is watching and jeering and cheering it on? And how would we really feel about that? I gotta say that I'm of two minds, because first and foremost, it's a movie. Now, of course, something being a movie doesn't mean that you should put anything in that movie. I'm against the censorship that Hammer had to endure, but at the same time, the rape scene as it's done off camera, it still, to me, is very effective, because the whole thing of rape is just so so shocking and so disheartening. It's just something really, really difficult to actually watch. So I didn't need a close-up view of the rape and details and all that. So sometimes maybe the censors were right. That's for you as an audience to decide for yourselves. But I'm of two minds here, because I think the scene as, I mean, even if the rape scene had taken place with a wolf creature and the guy watching, I think it would have fulfilled the sadistic nature of the Marquis even more. I think it would have been more effective in the film. I think it would have grabbed you more. But as it stands, the whole it kind of shifts the whole explanation of the beggar's motivations and, you know, the guy actually becoming a werewolf. Because, you know, clearly there, if the beggar had been a half wolf creature, we'd understand why the child that is born from the servant girl actually becomes a werewolf. But since we didn't have that and it wasn't allowed, the excuse is a little bit more difficult to get across to an audience, and possibly even a little bit more harder to actually believe. You know, Hammer Studios had to do battle many, many times with the British Board of Film Censors. And they were pretty much beholden to their rules and their laws, because if they did not follow the guidelines set by this institution, quite frankly, their films wouldn't see the light of day. And up to this film, The Curse of the Werewolf, Hammer had not had such an intense battle with the board as they had with Curse of the Werewolf. And this was a rigorous battle and a rigorous fight to get the film released as they saw fit. But as often is the case, it didn't happen. And the film pretty much went through many, many changes. In my opinion, it was neutered. It was less impactful. And the board got their way. Now, what I want to do is go over some of the changes that was requested by the board. In 1961, a rough print of the film was viewed by the board. And this is some of the suggestions that they said. After seeing the film, it's pretty point blank that they did not like it. As a matter of fact, many things they hate it. And, you know, in general, film critics were pretty much down on horror films anyway. They weren't considered just a classy way of storytelling. And many people would be very, very satisfied if horror films didn't exist. But at any rate, okay. The film board turned over a long list of cuts. These included a shot of the Marquis' flaky nose. Now, what they mean by that is in the film, apparently years and years have passed, and the Marquis, who is a sadistic man who just, you know, terrorizes the people underneath him, he gets old, and I suppose he develops some sort of skin condition. And his skin becomes really flaky and dried up, and it just looks pretty bad, all grayish. And there was a scene where Hammer kind of filmed him, you know, playing with the dead skin and flaking it off. And the censors did not like that, so they said that had to go. Okay. You know, you kind of laugh at this stuff now, but, you know, you got to catch your breath and realize this was years and years ago. And our acceptance of things was a lot less liberal as they are today. But anyway, the rape, they did not like the rape scene. And even though, you know, Hammer made changes to the rape scene and they let him keep it in, they still didn't like it. But they originally suggested that it had to go. The stabbing of the Marquis. Now, this evil guy does eventually get his comeuppance. And it's by the servant girl. She actually stabs him to death in the film. And the censors considered this too violent of an act. And although you might consider it, you know, with what he did to her, throwing her in prison, she getting raped, and, you know, then, you know, ordering her to his room to be raped again. So, you know, she retaliates. She kills him. And you would think that the board might feel like this is kind of justified, given everything that she's gone through. But they didn't like the rape scene. Okay. Dialogue about children born on Christmas Day. Now, the movie specifically says that it is taboo to have a kid or a child be born during the month of December. According to one of the elder feminine characters in the film, that month is reserved for the holy birth of Jesus, and it is unholy for children to be born in that month. And I just thought, where is that coming from? That just seems like such an off-the-wall sort of explanation to be added to the film. Now, of course, the censors didn't like that fact. I think they probably felt like, well, you know, Jesus was born in December, And we don't feel like it's right to have this child who turns into this killing creature to be born in the month of our Savior as well. So that's probably where that came from. That was the contention there. Okay. Then we have the baptism. Now in the movie, the young Leon as an infant is taken to the Catholic Church to be baptized. You know, that's what you do. And once the priest puts the holy water on his head, forehead, and face, there's a rumbling in the building, lightning, the sky is just cloudy. It looks like it gives you the impression that some force is objecting to the child being baptized. And I would just imagine that the censors felt like that was bordering on sacrilegion, because the force of God is strong enough, you know, to overcome whatever's inside this kid or whatever's causing this kid to be cursed. So, you know, that's the story of that. Okay. You know, these omissions that they ordered were pretty much arcane to us today, because I mean, you know, they're pretty tame by today's standards. So, you know, I'm reading this stuff and I'm obviously I'm getting a chuckle out of all of it, but you know, I try to place myself back in that time period to understand how they might have felt. And you know, I don't think it's too ridiculous for what they suggested, at least on some of the points, but I try to understand where they're coming from. Okay, then we have young Leon's hairy palms. Now, I don't really understand what they're getting at about the hairy palms. I mean, it's a boy changing or being cursed with that of a werewolf. So, you know, there's going to be hair. So, I don't know if, you know, why this would be of any kind of contention to the censors. Perhaps, you know, it goes back to that old saying, you know, if you masturbate, you grow hair in the palm of your hands. But I don't think that's what they were talking about. Were they? But anyway, that's just one that I just think, you know, I don't agree with that one. That one's kind of ridiculous. Okay. Then we have all three of the killings committed by the werewolf. Now, I've watched the film. I've seen the murders. And it is almost kind of impossible to be objective when you're born in a different time period from when an older film is made, and rules are different, and the way we see things are different. I have never seen the unedited version of this film, so I don't know what they did to manipulate the murder scenes. But I can say, seeing the uncut film, even with those, I don't think that they were too grisly, too bloody. And oftentimes, they took place, to me, as innuendos. I mean, you knew it was going to happen, but most of the violence was pretty much just assumed. But I don't, it was not too violent to me at all. And I'm trying to be in a point of view of being back in those days. Leon's transformation and the shots of the dead Leon's face. Now, I don't know, given the fact that Universal Pictures had done a werewolf film, and I'm sure many people in the UK had seen that film and the transformations and all that, I don't really understand why the censors would want to take out the werewolf's transformations. And I gotta say, that's pretty mind-boggling to me, because there's nothing really vicious or overly grotesque or anything like that about Leon's transformations. I mean, it consisted of, you know, his back to the camera, turning around and seeing protrusions in his face. And then there's a scene where, you know, we have these fake hands and there's stop-motion hair growing. It's probably not stop-motion, but you know what I mean. So I don't really get the whole transformation scene having to be taken out. But that's pretty much another mute and ridiculous point, in my opinion. And then not showing Leon's face when he was killed in the film, I really don't get that one either at all. But I will say, it really would be interesting to see this film edited in the way that the censors had suggested, because I just, all these cuts were just unnecessary, and they ruined the film. None of these suggestions were really all too great, and even the rape scene, it would have made much more sense to me to have the beggar be a half werewolf. I don't even know where this half werewolf stuff is even written in the story. I guess even Hammer probably thought, well, we can't make him full werewolf because the censors are definitely not going to pass that. But having the guy have fangs and all, I mean, I can understand why the censors objected, but at the same time, it would have just made so much more sense in the story. Instead of having this kid who's somehow cursed by some unnatural force, as if saying that this woman was subjected to bad deeds, and since she wasn't a willing partner in this, and since this guy was evil, her baby is cursed. So I don't know if Hammer was trying to make some kind of social commentary on the bad deeds done by people, but you can obviously take it that way. You know, you do bad things, and bad things are as or of a result of those bad things, which, you know, sometimes is the case, but sometimes it's not the case. So I don't know if Hammer was consciously making a statement, or that they were backed into a corner and just had to finish this film. I'm kind of leaning toward the second explanation, because as it stands, we really don't know or get any kind of explanation as to why this kid becomes a werewolf. It really to me boils down to the censors making Hammer do this film one way when they already had another way to solve the problem of why this kid's a werewolf. But at any rate, one of the scenes in the film that's kind of unsettling, and it doesn't involve any killing or anything like that, but it involves a little kid who's frequently seen or unseen running outside killing livestock. We don't see any of this, but we know he's doing it. And he tells his uncle or his adopted father that he keeps having these dreams of him killing animals, running outside. And he says, I killed a squirrel, and I went to kiss the squirrel to make it feel better. And I tasted its blood, and its blood was sweet. And that was kind of a really kind of unsettling amount of dialogue coming from that little kid. What's amazing is that the censors didn't cut that out or suggest that it be omitted from the story. So, you know, guys, I'm pretty sure that, you know, it was a really disheartening set of rules and a really disheartening meeting for the makers to have this film viewed and then listen to the British Board of Film Censors as to what they objected to. So if you can imagine Anthony Hines and Terrence Fisher, the legendary Terrence Fisher, who had directed this movie, were very disheartened by the fact that all these changes had been made mandate by the British Board of Film Censors. But the film was completed and released, and as a matter of fact, there were also trims and cuts to the film made when it was distributed in the United States by Universal. But one of the things that was really an opposite sort of reaction was that here in America, critics and audiences love the film. But back in Britain, the film was lukewarmly received and was not a very huge hit at all. The critics of the film in Britain were very, very harsh on it. By today's standard, and even in Britain, the movie is considered one of Hammer's best and one of their classics. And I think that's generally felt here in the United States. Now, what I'll say about the story itself is that basically, and I'll go over this very, very quickly. Basically, we have, at the beginning of the film, this beggar who comes into town and begs for food in this little village. He's shunned, and the people are definitely under some kind of strict rule of law. They complain that all their money goes to the ruling authority, the marquise in the town. So they say, if you want to go beg, go up to his mansion and ask for food. So that's what he does. He goes up there and the marquise makes a fool of him, jokes with him, treats him like an animal just for a drink of wine. And when he does give him food, he throws it on the floor. And to get this food and wine, get this, the marquise actually tells the beggar, how much will it cost to buy you? You're basically going to be a pet to my wife. You're an animal. And the guy's just so hungry, you know, it's not a big deal. Okay, I'll be your pet. Buy me. And, you know, he sells himself to the marquis for food and drink. And, you know, for all that, he ends up being jailed for 15 years. And he's fed by the jailer and the jailer's daughter, who at this time is a little girl. And by 15 years later, she's an adult. And a very beautiful woman. And she goes in to feed him. You know, he kind of teases her, the beggar, winks his eye at her. And you kind of think that maybe it's some kind of playful thing between the two of them, you know. Even though he's in jail, you know, she's taking care of him, she's fed him and all this, and maybe he's just joking with her. But apparently he is not. But anyway, she catches the attention of the marquise, whose wife has died from his mistreatment and horrible negative attitude. So I guess she died of depression. And he sees how beautiful the jailer's daughter is, and he forces himself on her. And she pretty much, you know, shuns him. And for this, she is thrown into jail. And in the jail with the beggar, he ends up raping her. And I was a little bit disappointed with this in that, you know, she had fed him for years and years. And now that she's in a cell with him, he wants to do her harm. And I just thought, you know, that's where it goes back to the whole thing where if he was half wolf, you would kind of expect this beastly behavior. Maybe he can't control himself. But when the censors made Hammer change this to where he could not be a half-wolf creature, the rape comes across as, hey, dude, she was nice to you all your life. She's the only one that brought you food. Basically, the only one that kept you alive. And you do this to her? You rape her? But anyway, he rapes her. And then, even after being in prison, this shows you just how sadistic the Marquis is. Even after she's been thrown in jail, raped, the jailer, one of the Marquis guards, releases her and tells her to get her act together and go to the Marquis' room. She doesn't shower, she doesn't bathe, nothing. She just goes straight to his room where he wants to sleep with her. And she kills him. And then she runs away from the mansion, is found by a kindly Spanish man and brought to his house. And his housekeeper soon discovers that she's pregnant. She gives birth to a little boy, I believe his name was Leon, and shortly after, she dies from the birth. Leon is cursed with that of werewolf blood, which once again makes really little sense considering the fact that the beggar was just a mad, crazed man and had no werewolf blood in him at all. But you know, we see some events in the film when Leon's a kid, sheep getting killed, and things of that nature, but no one can really put their fingers on it. But the man ends up adopting a little kid who, the kid kind of becomes his son, and he knows that there's some kind of evil going on with the kid, and he contacts the rabbi, and the preacher tells him more or less, you know, the force of love will keep this evil at bay. And when one day he meets a young woman and she loves him and he loves her, this curse will pretty much, their love will discontinue this curse and it'll just bring it to an end. So, you know, we switch to years when Leon's a grown man and he's found a girl that he loves. They love each other. It's a forbidden love because the father does not like him. And that's pretty much in all these films. You know, you fall in love with the girl that no father wants you to be with. But one night, you know, he gets a little bit sick. And this, I'm assuming the girl's a prostitute. And the nature of this prostitute is kind of strange, too, because the book speaks of the British Board of Film Censors actually demanding that a scene with the prostitute be cut, because it's pretty much left in the film as, does this girl work here? Is she a prostitute? Because Leon and his friend go out to a bar, and they're entertained by these girls, but we never really understand if the girls... Leon has a date, but another one of the girls watches him, and when he goes outside to get some fresh air because he's sick, she shuffles him up to her room and lays him down in bed and tries to care for him a little bit, although you know she has plans to do more than that. Now, the film lightly touches on whether or not what her goals are. So, I don't know if the film is saying that since he was willing to mess around with this lady, and he eventually lets passion overtake him and he starts to kiss her, and I don't know if that's the trigger for him actually, the curse gaining the strength to actually affect him and turn him into a werewolf, because that's when the trouble begins. He succumbs to the full moon, and basically he goes on a killing spree, and he has to be put down at the end of the movie. You know, one of the things that I liked about the film is the fact that the actor Clifford Evans was just so warm and kind in the character that he played. I mean, you know, he welcomed the servant girl into his home. After she gave birth and died, he kept the baby, he raised the child. He was such a welcoming and gentle character. I really appreciated him. And it had been so long since I saw the film, I didn't realize what was going to happen to his character in the film, but I kept thinking, please don't kill him. Please don't kill him. He's just too nice a person to be killed. But at any rate, I really appreciated his character. I thought he was just the kindest man, just really a nice soul. And I know maybe you don't hear that very often, you know, but I really liked him. I liked his housekeeper, the kindly, motherly woman who was very, very motherly to the child and very caring. And matter of fact, the whole household was just a very caring sort of place. And even the interiors of the sets and all look very warm and friendly and welcoming. I gotta say that, you know, Yvonne Romaine, who played the servant girl, very beautiful actress, continuing the line of Hammer's sensual actresses, really good in the part. I really felt for her character. I just really, you know, felt really, really bad about all the harsh things that she went through in this film. And I was just like, my goodness. I mean, she performed in the role. She did a great job in the film. And I really felt affected by what her character went through. And just for the small amount of screen time that she has in the movie, she just went through hell. Her whole time in the movie was just going through hell. And, you know, she died after giving birth to the kid. But if you think about it, if she had lived, it would have been more hell as her kid, she'd have watched her kid become a killer. So, you know, it's just, she just did not make out very good in this film. But as an actress and for the character she played, she did a really exceptional job. And that's another thing about this movie. You know, the whole beginning, the whole starting of this film was just, to me, one of the best beginnings in a Hammer film. I really liked how it just seemed so out there and so different, and you just really didn't know where it was gonna go. But you know, seriously, I would have to say that Catherine Fella, the love interest of Leon, is probably the weakest link in this film. It was just something about her, at least to me, that just seemed so out of place. She wasn't your typical Hammer romantic interest. And I'm not talking or speaking of the fact that, you know, the Hammer girls are usually just full-figured, sultry, vivacious, very sexy. She was almost the exact opposite, and her character was just so uninteresting. And almost to the point, at least to me, where, you know, it bordered on believability. She just did not seem like the actress for the role to me. And dare I say, she might have been just a little bit miscast. But, you know, I just wasn't convinced by the romance. And much of that is just due to the fact that, you know, she didn't come into the movie pretty much until after Leon's character came in the movie. And there just was not enough time to build this relationship to where, you know, when she finally learns what Leon's true identity is, you know, she's shocked and in horror and all that. But you don't really feel anything as an audience because, you know, there's just no time put in this relationship. I mean, you know, even at the end when Leon gets what's coming to him, you don't really feel anything for her pain or the tragedy of the story or anything like that. And like I said, I think much of that is due to the fact that it just all happens so late in the movie. You know, Curse of the Werewolf. I gotta say, what I liked about the movie were the beautiful sets. The set pieces were just beautiful. The Spanish village, the surroundings, everything looked so authentic. It transported me to that time period, and it was just totally remarkable. I felt totally, 100%ly that I was in those days experiencing this movie. And secondly, I thought that the makeup for the werewolf was just totally incredible. I really liked this makeup. Really liked it. The actors. Not a problem with the actors at all. The film is very, very slow paced. There's very, very little werewolf action in the film. And as a matter of fact, you don't really fully see the werewolf until the last 15, maybe 10 minutes of the movie, which is a damn shame given how epic this makeup is. You don't ever see the werewolf just fucking go wolf mad and just create a string of murders, just totally go epic and just cause all kinds of hell. And that's really a shame, and it's surprising in that, you know, when we have Dracula films, we see the creature, we see the blood, nothing is hidden. When we have Frankenstein films, we see the murders, we see the evil, but when it comes to the werewolf, it's much more subdued. I think the film was on to being a really great movie. And if it had been the only werewolf film that Hammer had ever done, it would have been epic. But as it stands, I think it suffers from slow pacing with not a lot happening during the course of the film. Although we have Oliver Reed starring in this film, and I've seen many of his pictures, he's a wonderful actor. He's a very, very competent actor. I think we can all agree upon that. But the problem here is that although he's in this film, he doesn't come into the movie up until about 45, 50 minutes into the film. And by that time of the movie, it's really, really hard to develop him as a character simply because there's just simply isn't enough runtime left. And one thing, I've said this before, one thing that I remember vividly about Universal Studios werewolf picture with Lon Chaney Jr. And I've seen this film once when I was very, very young. But the thing that I take from this movie more than anything is the fact that what comes to mind front and foremost is the fact that Lon Chaney gave this great performance of this tortured man, this tortured soul who hated what he had become, hated what he had done. And the film spends a great deal of time on setting him up as this tortured human being who is a victim, who you feel sorry for. I remember watching that film and feeling so sorry for the situation that Lon Chaney's character was in. And that's where I draw comparisons to Hammer's Curse of the Werewolf, because that is totally missing from this film. There's really, although we see the character going through mostly disbelief and just hell as far as, you know, the shock of it all, he doesn't really get to emote. We don't really get close to this man, his inner workings, to actually feel that hell that he's going through. And I think that sorely hurts this character, because you feel bad for what he's going through. You think it's unfair, but there's just not enough time to develop all those feelings and to make us really feel saddened. We don't really feel the tragedy of the situation, even though he's been put in a totally unfair situation beyond his control. And I think that, you know, having this great actor, even though, you know, he was pretty relatively new at the time, having the focus not really be on him as a human being ultimately hurt the film very, very much. And it just would have been so much better if we could really shed some tears and really feel some empathy for this man. But unfortunately, you know, when they had him come into the film over halfway through almost, you know, you just, those feelings are pretty much, you know, it's not enough time to generate them. And I think less time should have been spent on him as a child and, you know, going around seeing him, you know, kill some of the sheep herders, goats and sheep and all that. Instead, we should have put that time towards developing Oliver Reed's character. It would have served the film much better in the end. Now, with that said, guys, I was disappointed overall with the movie. I think that it had great potential. I think it's really hit and miss. I think there were some great things started in this film. I just wish that the filmmakers have not been so heavily scrutinized by the board of censors, and I wish they had been allowed to do their thing. But with that said, too, there were shortcomings in the story. Front and foremost, Oliver Reed's character. I love the characters that played the surrogate father and the surrogate aunt or grandmother. Great characters. Really, really beautiful people. I liked them. But at the end of the day, I enjoyed the film, but I think it had much more potential to be a great, great movie. Now, would I call it a classic film? Indeed, I would. It's still a classic film, despite its shortcomings. So there you have it, everybody. My thoughts on Hammer's Curse of the Werewolf. A well-made, beautifully shot movie with some exquisite makeup, some great actors who transport you to that time, and unfortunately, just some important shortcomings as far as the story. But ultimately, I feel like the censors were the real downfall of this movie. I think they really hindered what this movie could have ultimately become. If they'd allowed Hammer to do their thing, this movie would have been priceless. But anyway, thanks for watching, everybody, and I'll see you at the next Hammer Films review. Thanks for watching.